your good side, or you want me to have her stand over here?
It does not matter.
You don't have a good side.
They're both equally poor, Judge.
Oh, boy. Okay. Anybody about ready? All right, now let me sort of tell you where I think we need to go. For Mr. Sweeney's benefit as well. This is a case brought by the Forsyth County Board of Ethics, and therefore they have the right to proceed first in the scheme of things. And I would expect to hear, if you'd like to make an opening statement, would you like to, either one of you like to make an opening statement? I've read all the pleadings two or three times. I got 8 pages of notes, by the way.
I'm sure, Judge. If I could just, I guess, try to make a brief clarification. I think the substantive issue before the court today is Mr. Sweeney's complaints against the individual board members. The board filed a declaratory judgment style Board of Ethics versus Mr. Sweeney in order to get guidance on who was going to hear Mr. Sweeney's complaints, and your ruling was that this court would hear the complaints. So with that being said, procedurally, I would say that it's Mr. Sweeney's complaints against the individual board members, and that Mr. Sweeney should probably go first and act as plaintiff, procedurally speaking. But that's just an option, Judge. We'll proceed however the court directs us. But procedurally it's a little tricky because it is the Board of Ethics bringing the declaratory judgment to figure out who would hear Mr. Sweeney's complaints. And however you direct us to proceed, Judge, we will.
What do you say, Mr. Sweeney?
Let me think about that for 1 second, Judge.
Sure.
The one issue that I'm having is the Mr. Butler is the hearing officer for the Board of Ethics, and
the hearing officer. He's the attorney for the.
He's the attorney.
Yeah, not the hearing officer.
Well, the problem is that Mr. Butler can possibly be called as a witness.
Well, we'll deal with that if that occurs.
Okay. And I don't have a problem with them, with their opening statement. This way I can follow up on them, on what they say.
All right, so you can go. You understand you go first.
Well, I would like to go second if that's okay.
All right, we'll do that. That will be fine. We'll let you go second. Now, okay, you can have a seat. I've been doing this this is my 57th year to be a lawyer and my 30th year to be a Superior Court judge. And I don't, I require respect for each other, and that's what we will have. But as far as formality, I'm not much for formality. I remember I had a big, big case in Heard County, and with two law firms in Atlanta were involved, one on each side. And we had a pretrial in Paul Goldstein's law firm's office in Atlanta. And when it was all over, one of the lawyers said, "Judge, you know, everybody has their idiosyncrasies. Can you tell us what yours are?" And I said, "The only one I know of is I don't like noise. And if there's any shouting or yelling or carrying on, then I quit listening. But other than that, I believe that everybody has a right to be heard, and I certainly will hear from everyone." Now, Mr. Sweeney, I understand you're not a member of the bar. The way the case will proceed, of course, is that the Forsyth County Board of Ethics will present their case. They will call witnesses. The witnesses will be sworn to tell the truth. They will take the witness stand. Mr. Butler will ask them questions. And then you have a right to ask them questions after Mr. Butler is finished. Then if he asks more, then you have a right to ask more. It's not the purpose of it when you examine witnesses for you to testify or for you to make statements. The purpose of the witness is for your examination of the witness is to ask them questions so I can get the information from them. Then after Mr. Butler and the board has completed completed their presentation of the evidence, then you will have the right, if you so desire, to take the witness stand, be put under oath, and say anything to me you want to say. And then Mr. Butler will have a right to ask you questions. And of course, you can call witnesses as well, and these witnesses will be put under oath and will follow the same procedure. Any witness that you call, you have the right to ask them questions first, and then Mr. Butler will have the right to ask them questions next. Again, when you ask questions, it's not the time for you to make a statement. You'll have your opportunity, I promise that, to say whatever you want to say. All right, do we have any other questions? Anybody want sequestration of the witnesses?
Judge, if I could, I just clarify one other issue, and I know you're not going to be overly formal with the procedure.
No.
And I'm fine with that. But since the substance is the Sweeney complaint against the board members, Mr. Charles is here, Robert Charles, he's the current chair of the board. And technically he's representing himself today, Judge. I'm not acting as his attorney, I'm the attorney for the Board of Ethics. So I wanted to clarify that, Judge. And Mr. Turner is here. He was an alternate member for some hearings that took place this past summer. I recused from those hearings, so I don't know much about them. He has a doctor's appointment. He showed up. He's filed his answer, Judge, and he's basically just going to rest on the pleadings. He wanted to come in, but then he's going to have to leave for a pre-scheduled doctor's appointment. So when it comes to, I guess, my responsibility, I don't think I should be, I guess, questioning Mr. Charles, as I'm not his attorney, but I will follow the court's guidance on how you want us to proceed.
I would ask that you question him, but based upon the fact that it's easier for me to get the facts when someone asks the questions and I listen to the answers. How about the sequestration of witnesses? Either side desire that?
Yes, we'll invoke the rule of sequestration, Judge.
All right, well, that requires all the witnesses who are to be called to testify will be have to remain outside the hearing room or the courtroom until such time as they are called to testify. And then the rule of sequestration requires that once a witness has testified, that witness cannot discuss their testimony with any other witness. You have any witnesses, Mr. Sweeney?
No, sir.
You don't either?
No, just both of these are respondents, so they have a right to be in here. We don't have any witnesses other than the parties, Judge.
Okay. Why don't you proceed?
All right, Judge, just in way of opening briefly, just to outline for the court what I think the pertinent issues are, is the complaint is about Board of Ethics meetings that were held, I guess, not on a date or time as outlined in the previous ordinance, or not in a location as outlined in the previous ordinance. However, they were published and the public attended and they were open meetings, Judge. I think the evidence you're going to hear is going to show that the previous ordinance was impossible to follow for the board to conduct their business, so they did what they had to do, and the ordinance has since been modified to fix that issue, Judge. So I think those are the issues that are before the court, and those would be the issues I would ask the court to pay attention to.
All right, Mr. Sweeney, do you desire to make an opening statement?
Yes, Judge. The chairman, let me just ask one other question to you, Judge.
Sure.
Since I thought I wasn't going to be calling any witnesses, would I be able to call Mr. Charles as a witness at this time?
Well, yeah, but probably he will have already been called by Mr. Butler's side, and then you can examine him. Yes, yes, yes. Certainly you're going to be able to ask him questions, yes.
I'd rather just, I'll wait for the witnesses.
Okay, very good. Thank you, sir. Go ahead.
We'll see. Charles, we take the witness stand. Yes, sir, right there. Please raise your right hand. Do you solemnly swear or affirm the testimony you'll give in the matter pending before the court today to be the truth, the whole truth, and nothing but the truth, so help you God?
I do.
All right, you can have a seat, Mr. Charles.
I feel like I know all these people. I've been watching these videos.
You should know everybody. Mr. Charles, will you please introduce yourself to the judge?
Yes, Judge. I'm Bob Charles. I'm the current chairman of the Board of Ethics. He's acting chairman at some points during the time period of the complaint. I've been a member of the board for, I believe it's been roughly 4 years now.
And can you briefly describe for the judge what the Board of Ethics does in Forsyth County?
Sure. The Board of Ethics basically is there to hear look at evidence that might be presented when a complaint is brought by any member of the public against any of the elected officials, employees, public servant type folks in the county. We are there solely to look at information that's brought in light of the ordinance in Forsyth County, the ethics ordinance and how it's written. So our job is essentially to determine if there's been a violation of ethics rules, you know, per what we're given in the ordinances.
So what is the controlling law or document that you have to base all your decisions on?
All the decisions have to be based on the ethics ordinance in the county, which is found in the Munich Code, is updated from time to time. We basically have to go by that information, which does reference some other ethics rules that the state of Georgia has as well. But we're bound by the rules that are within those documents.
And Judge, to perfect the record, at the last hearing, we introduced into evidence a certified copy of the ethics ordinance.
Does the court reporter have that?
Excuse me, Judge?
The court reporter have that?
I don't. There's a different court reporter. I handed it to you, Judge. I don't know
okay,
if you kept it with you.
Well, let's, is this it right here?
May I approach, Judge?
Yeah, sure. Yeah.
That is, Judge.
That's plaintiff's exhibit number one, but I have that, and I've, here, I'm going to get you to type up this record and mail it to me so that I can have it when I write the judgment. And I'll get the information from you, and then I'll mail this to you. Go ahead.
Judge, if I may see plaintiff's exhibit one briefly. Mr. Charles, will you please thumb through plaintiff's exhibit one?
Sure.
I'm sorry. Let me show it to Mr. Sweeney's reference. Sorry, Mr. Sweeney.
That's fine. Oh, this is the ordinance.
It is.
Thank you.
It's a certified copy of the ordinance.
Yeah, I think there's a bunch of them in there. There's ordinance 77C, 77B, and 77F.
That's correct, Judge. The original ordinance was 77, and the letters represent certain amendments that have occurred over time.
Okay.
Mr. Charles, when you're thumbing through that, just look at it and tell the board if you can recognize the document, what that document is.
Yes, this appears to be the ordinance, the ethics ordinance.
Is that the ordinance that you are required to follow when you conduct Board of Ethics business?
Yes, it is.
Thank you. There you go, Judge.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Charles, can you also, I guess, briefly describe for the court who makes up the Forsyth County Board of Ethics?
Well, the Board of Ethics is made up of appointees by various constituencies within the county. For example, I'm appointed by the Board of Commissioners. We have an appointee from the Bar Association. We have an appointee from elected officials in the county other than the commissioners. We have an appointee from the employees in the county and the like. So these are folks who are appointed by vote of their particular constituency in the county to provide a balanced representation on the Board of Ethics.
Do you have the ability to accept or reject that appointment?
We, as a board, do not have the ability to do that. No, we have only the ability to potentially appoint an alternate in the case if somebody's not available.
Do any members of the Board of Ethics receive any form of compensation for their service to the county?
They do not. It is purely voluntary. There's no compensation, nor is there any expense reimbursement of any kind.
Do you work anywhere, Mr. Charles?
I do.
Where do you work?
I'm employed by an Intel corporation, so I've been there for 20 years.
Do other members of the Board of Ethics have regular full-time jobs, to the best of your knowledge?
They do. The other members have regular jobs and other responsibilities outside of this, and this is something that they have volunteered to do on their own time as a way to assist in public service in the county.
Mr. Sweeney,
yes.
Just show this to
27B.
To Mr. Charles.
Okay, thank you.
Mr. Charles, I'm showing what's been marked as plaintiff's exhibit two for identification purposes. Will you take a look at that document and tell me if you know what it is?
Yes, I believe this is one of the more recent amendments to the ordinance that was put in place to correct some of the technical language of meeting setting that was in the previous ordinance that actually kind of created a circular situation where we were unable to follow exactly what the letter of the ordinance was.
Okay. And what is the title of that particular amendment to the ordinance, 77-B? Dash B.
Your Honor?
Yes, sir.
That amended ordinance is not in question today.
I understand. It was adopted after your complaint.
Yeah.
I understand. Go ahead, Mr. Butler.
All right, thank you, Judge.
But I understand that it was adopted subsequent to the filing of your complaint.
It was, Judge.
I understand.
Mr. Charles, can you describe for the court, prior to this amendment 77B, what was the guidelines and the ethics ordinance for the board to set meetings and hold meetings?
So the guidelines in the ethics ordinance were such that the board had to set meetings by majority vote of the board, in essence. And so
I don't think that's right. I think, as I understand it, it's either by the majority of the board or the chairman.
Yes, Judge, in the
isn't that right?
The issue almost actually comes down to the last line of that section of the ordinance, which is that the time for the meeting has
the
to be established.
Yeah, yes. But the call of the meeting either is majority of the board or the call of the chair.
Correct.
That part's correct, Judge.
All right.
Okay. Under this previous version of the ordinance, which is the one at issue today, what problems did that cause for the Board of Ethics in scheduling and setting meeting times?
Sure. So there were really two things that have taken place over time, and actually not having the data right in front of me, but my memory serves me, I believe one of them was corrected mid last year, the other is corrected by this document you've shown me. But the first one had to do with when the ordinance, I believe, was originally established, there were some dates, specific dates that were picked, or specific days of a week of a particular month of the year that were picked for what would be the two regular meetings that need to be scheduled by the Board of Ethics. And those are really just procedural meetings. Oftentimes they were very short and nothing of particular substance was generally done. There was just a meeting to establish the board and keep it operating. First of all, let's deal with the days. That particular thing creates some problems in that we have five members of the board, all of whom are volunteers with other jobs. We also have our counsel, in many cases yourself, in some cases the alternate counsel. We also have our clerk. And we also have the need for a meeting room as well. So we had a situation where it was not always possible to get enough of the members available and all of the parties that are available on one day, or even a room available on a given day. And so what we would endeavor always to do is have all members present, if at all possible. For one thing, the ordinance is such that we can't rotate any action without at least three of the five members. And we can't take any action on an ethics complaint without four of the five. So, as you can imagine, having the most folks available is important. We certainly think it is. In addition, the fact that each of the five appointees comes from a different area, a different set of constituencies, we always wanted to try to have everybody represented so that we could claim that we were taking action without, you know, the person who they had voted to represent them on the board being present. So we always made a real effort to try to have everybody available, whatever possible, certainly four of the five. So that's certainly one of the things that presented a problem. We often just simply run into times where people were not available or even the room was not available. The other thing in question was the room that we met in. It actually was written in the original ordinance, I believe, that we needed to meet in the commissioner's meeting room, which would be the the large meeting room where the commissioners actually have their public meetings. This is something that even, I believe, predates my service on the board. The board is obviously a pretty small group of people, even with the handful of public participants we normally have, unless there's something very unusual. And so we would generally try to meet in the large conference room, which was obviously a little bit more of a conducive environment for that smaller group to meet. It also didn't require us to get availability and fire up all the lighting and the like in the large room. So that had just, I guess, become practice. We discovered that. I don't recall exactly who discovered it. It may have been our counsel or the county's attorney, and that was fixed. I believe the meeting room location part was fixed middle of last year by an update there. And this particular one right here fixed the other problem of the specific dates and allowed some flexibility such that, you know, we could try to ensure that the maximum number of members to participate in any board meeting, whether it was a regular board meeting or a called board meeting.
Okay. Does the ethics board in any way publish the meeting dates, times, and locations to the public?
Absolutely. Not only are we required to do so under the Open Meetings Act, but we also, I would say, in my term anyway, on the board, we have gone out of our way to make sure that we maximize the amount of notice that we're able to give based on the scheduling. So, in fact, we have actually, when it's come to special meeting, we've actually pushed out scheduling of a meeting because we didn't think there was enough time, even though we were technically in compliance with the notification requirements of open meetings. But we've always tried to give as much notice as we can, unless it's an unusual situation.
What sort of importance does the ethics board put on having an open meeting and having as much notice to the public as possible?
I mean, we think it's critical, especially in light of the fact of the type of board that we are. We're the ethics board, so we're trying to make sure that everything we do is as transparent as it can be. We're trying to make sure that anybody who's interested can attend, especially when there's an actual ethics complaint that's been alleged. We want to make sure that the parties involved have an opportunity to attend if they so choose. Sometimes they do, sometimes they don't. But I always want to make sure that the press is able to be there. Certainly, you know, public confidence in the Board of Ethics is very important. And so we do try to make sure that we're meeting in such a way that people have notice and attend if they want.
To the best of your knowledge, do you know if the Ethics Board has ever met without complying with the public notice requirements?
No, we have not.
All right, I want to draw your attention specifically to some of the issues raised in Mr. Sweeney's complaint against you and other members of the board. And without going tick by tick on each one of the issues is that during some times in the summer of 2011 and into the fall of 2011, the Ethics Board did not meet in the correct room that's dictated by the ordinance in place at the time.
I think there was one date, wasn't it, Mr. Sweeney? That's July 12th.
July 8th or the 12th?
12th. It was 12th. Yes. That's the one time they did not meet in the commissioner's meeting room, but met at the public safety.
Complex,
yes. Okay, fully.
All right, well, with that specification, Mr. Charles, what can you tell the court about what happened that day and why it happened?
The public safety complex has generally been a backup location. So not only does that happen when we have people scheduling problems, but it happens sometimes when we have room scheduling problems. So if we're not able to get another room, we will use that because there's a conference room of adequate size over there to hold the board as well as members of the public that would come in. And so that's why that would take place over there.
Was that meeting published for the public?
Oh, absolutely.
Did
along with its location and everything.
Did members of the public attend that meeting, to the best of your knowledge?
I believe they did, yes. I think we've had at least some members of the public at virtually every meeting I can remember, or at least a member of the press there, yes.
Another complaint is that on July 8th, 2011, the meeting time was failed, was not established by majority vote. What can you tell the court about that particular incident, why it happened?
A majority vote. It was not, it was established based upon availability of the members. And frankly, the way that we will generally do that is over email, or the clerk will call individual members if the email is not prudent and find out what their availability is. We will also cross-coordinate that with the appropriate counsel for that meeting, as well as the clerk's availability, and finally, the room's availability. Once we establish a time and date when that all aligns, we will then establish the meeting that way per my calls.
These meetings that are alleged in the complaint, July 8th and July 12th, what sort of business was the Ethics Board conducting in these meetings?
Without having notes in front of me, I don't want to speculate. We have two types of meetings. There is either a standard meeting, which is required two times a year. In some of those meetings, we also try to incorporate at the end if we have a current ethics complaint in front of us. We'll try to run that in the same meeting. And the rest of the meetings would be based upon an ethics complaint. So the ones in July should have been based upon an ethics complaint at the time.
What 2 months do you normally have your regular meetings with the Ethics Board?
Normally, we try to target May and November, as those were originally the ones stipulated in the ordinance.
Now, these July dates that you've testified would have been a complaint meeting, or the board was somehow investigating or reviewing a complaint. Do you recall who filed that complaint?
I believe that complaint was filed by Mr. Sweeney.
Do you recall who that complaint was against?
I believe was a complaint against three of the sitting commissioners, board commission members.
Do you recall what the outcome?
County commissioners or city commissioners?
My apologies, county commissioners.
Do you recall what the outcome of the Ethics Board investigation into Mr. Sweeney's complaints against the county commissioner was?
Yes, ultimately those complaints were dismissed.
Okay. There's another complaint, or particular complaint in here, that on July 12th, you and the Ethics Board failed to have that meeting established by a majority vote of the Board of Ethics. Do you recall anything about that particular incident?
Yes, it's identical to the previous one. We try to establish the meetings as quickly as we can, based upon availability of the members and the council and the clerk, as well as the room. And we also try to do it in such a way that we can also provide maximum notice for public posting of the meeting. It should be noted that in a situation of a complaint, we are under some time constraint as well. We need to meet about the complaint within a timely manner, and balance that with giving notice to both the party of the complaint and the general public. So scheduling is not a trivial matter in a lot of these cases.
Further complaints against you and the board are that on November 30th, 2011, that being the fifth Wednesday of the month, there was an allegedly unlawful meeting time. Do you recall anything about this November 30th meeting, Mr. Charles?
I believe the November 30th meeting was a regular meeting of the Board of Ethics, as per required by the ordinance, that we meet twice a year in a regular meeting format, with regardless of whether there's a current complaint or not.
And the ordinance in effect at that time would have required y'all to meet on, I believe, the second Tuesday of November?
That's correct, yes.
Why couldn't y'all meet on the second Tuesday in November?
Again, it was availability of the board to meet. And I don't recall whether there was also a room conflict at that time or not. We've had a variety of those come up at any given time, whether it's been for a regular meeting or a call meeting. But certainly, it's typically availability of all five members of the board getting them all together at one time. We have folks that that do travel, including myself, for their normal course of business. And so it's not always possible to align on that prescribed date.
To the best of your knowledge, has the Ethics Board ever held one of these meetings not on the appropriate day or time in an effort to not be public?
No, absolutely not. That's the last thing we would do. In fact, we, again, go out of our way to make sure there's public notice for these.
The new ordinance that has been amended, the 77B ordinance that we have, as part of plaintiff's one. I have it in front of you as plaintiff's two, just for identification purposes. What has that done to correct this issue of scheduling? Because that's what I'm hearing you talk about. What has that done?
It's basically given more flexibility to the date. Instead of putting it on a very specific date, it has given some more flexibility around that. It has also, I believe, removed the majority vote to schedule the time, which became an impossibility for obvious reasons. And so it allows us to schedule a meeting. Either allows the chairman to schedule a meeting, or allows the office of the board to schedule a meeting. We happen to be scheduling it during one of our regular meetings.
Let me ask you something. Were there four members of the board at that time? There was a vacancy, right?
I'm trying to think now if there was a vacancy. We've had situations, Judge, where maybe a member will have to recuse themselves based on a particular thing in front of us, and we appoint an alternate at that time. We did have a period of time where actually the previous chairman elected not to continue his service on the board, and so we had, if I recall, some alternate membership at the time. But we've always tried to have a full five members.
But when you had these meetings that were called, were there any board members absent because either they didn't have notice or they couldn't be there?
Oh, no.
Everybody was present.
Yes, and nobody, if there was an absence, it would have been because somebody, either had a scheduling issue or we didn't have member. But I'm trying to recall, I believe we've had everybody there at most of these meetings. No one was ever absent because they didn't have notice.
Okay, go ahead.
And the amendment to the ordinance 77B, has that done anything to assist the board with scheduling a meeting location as well?
It has, and in fact, I almost think we had that in a previous amendment as well. But at any rate, it has allowed the board to schedule meetings at a room provided by the Board of Commissioners. So that certainly allows the use of the large conference room. It would allow the use of the public safety conference room if need be. So it gives the flexibility in us being able to pick from at least three or four rooms potentially that would be workable for the board size as well as the public to attend.
For all these meetings that were brought into question by this complaint, were they held in a public building, in a public room?
Yes, they were. And in fact, when it hasn't been held over in the public safety, it's been held in a large conference room, which is probably more than 100 feet away from the main commissioner's meeting room. So in the same building, same floor.
Mr. Charles, is there anything else you would like to tell the judge about these incidents that I have neglected to ask you about that feels important for the court to hear?
I think most of it's been covered in the questioning, Your Honor. I would just say that, this is an all-volunteer board of folks trying to do the right thing for the county. We had obviously some language in the ordinance that, if followed to a T, would actually preclude us from ever scheduling anything based on the majority vote required to set the time for the meeting. We think it's important to have as many members present, if not all of them, as possible during any of our meetings, so that the people who have appointed them have their presentation. And at no time during any of the meetings in question was there any damage to the ability of folks to attend or to have notice. It all complied with the Open Meetings Act. So certainly in the spirit of what was intended when the ordinance was set up, I believe we all that.
As far as you know, did any member of the Board of Ethics get any benefit whatsoever because of the change in the meeting location or the time of the meeting?
Only benefit would be the ability for someone to attend who otherwise might not have been able to. It's very similar to the situation we faced with Mr. Sweeney's current complaint, where it was against every member of the Board of Ethics. There was no particular language that prescribed how we should handle that, because obviously we would all need to recuse ourselves. In fact, I guess if you think about it, if somebody ever brought a complaint against any more than two members of the board at any one time, there wouldn't be enough of a quorum to appoint alternates. So it's just one of those unusual things I think maybe wasn't thought of in the language when it was originally written. But certainly none of this has been done with any ill intent, with any attempt to evade anything. and certainly not with any attempt to preclude the public or press attendance.
No, Judge, I don't have any further questions.
I'm Mr. Sweeney, and ask any questions you'd like to ask.
Thank you. One second. Morning, Judge.
Morning.
Mr. Charles.
Morning.
Mr. Charles seems to be a very nice guy. With your here,
nice guys get sued too, you know.
I agree.
Go ahead.
I have a Mr. Charles's response to my complaint here. I'd like to ask him a few questions about
Sir?
It. Does this look familiar?
Yes, sir. That appears to be my response to your complaint.
Thank you. Did you discuss or were you coached at all regarding that affidavit that you have there?
I did have assistance from counsel for that, yes.
The other responses are exactly the same. Did you have the same counsel as them, or were you coached earlier before you got to this hearing?
I can't speak for what the others may have filed. I can only speak for mine.
So were you coached before you got here to explain how everything was supposed to come down here?
At this particular meeting? No, sir.
So you say you didn't discuss this with anybody?
Are we talking about the response, or I'm not clear on what you're asking?
Oh, today's hearing.
Today's
just
hearing?
Just in general.
Mr. Butler and I spoke about whether I needed to attend today's hearing or not, because of the unusual situation of it, where the complaint was filed with the Ethics Board, and obviously the Ethics Board could not hear the complaint.
Well, Mr. Butler's not your counsel.
He is not.
In your response to my complaint, there are no specific dates noticed here as far as the times and the dates that I've made the complaint about. Can you tell me why there weren't any specific dates noted in your affidavit? Specifically, Ordinance 77B.
I'm not sure I understand the question, Mr. Sweeney.
Well, it says under Ordinance 77B, the responses must be supported by affidavits based on personal knowledge as required by Ethics Ordinance 2-124, and no such affidavits of personal knowledge are attached.
Okay. Yes, I basically signed the response and also provided a notarized verification that was in fact my response.
Give me a second, Judge.
You take all the time you need, Mr. Sweeney.
Thank you.
We're not here to rush through anything.
Thank you. Mr. Charles, my complaint is basically based on not having the meetings at the right place, the right time, and not having any postings in the right place. How did that happen?
Judge, I don't want to be too formal. That's kind of a compound question. If Mr. Charles could just break it down, I think it'll help everyone understand his answer.
Also, Mr. Sweeney, you anticipated that he would answer, yes, it was done incorrectly, then why was it done incorrectly? You asked him first whether how it was done, and then you can decide whether or not it was, we can decide whether or not it was done incorrectly. Just add, I'm interested in facts. That's what I'm interested in.
Can I take a 10-minute recess?
Certainly can. We'll be in a recess now. It'll 10 minutes to 10.
Thank you, Judge.
Yes, sir. You ready now?
In 1 minute I will be. Yes.
Just tell me when you're ready. You still got 7 minutes. It's your choice.
Thank you.
Anytime you're ready.
Yes, I'm ready, Judge.
Okay.
All right, Your Honor, I'm going to respond to Mr. Charles's answers to Mr.
When you get your chance to testify, you make all the responses. I've been doing so long, I got to have things in sequence and in order. Your purpose now, Mr. Sweeney, is to ask him questions. Now, you're going to give him, you're going to be given the opportunity to tell me anything you want to tell me. You can tell me about going fishing this past weekend. That's what these guys have been telling me about. Anything you want to tell me, but right now you ask him questions.
Thank you. I don't think I have any questions.
All right, that's fine. Anything further, Mr. Butler? Or
no, sir. Back? If he could step down, Judge.
Anything further?
No, Judge.
Do you want to testify, Mr. Sweeney?
No, thank you. No, sir.
You don't want to testify at all?
No, I would like to rebut everything that was said earlier.
Okay, we take the witness stand. Raise your right hand. Do you swear the evidence given this matter shall be the truth, nothing but the truth, so help you God?
Yes, I do.
Now you sit down, tell me what you want to tell me, and I'm taking notes as you go.
Okay, thank you very much, Judge. Failures of respondents to follow the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance in responding to the Sweeney complaint.
If I could just know what he's reading from, I'd appreciate it.
Oh, I'm sorry. This is my updated affidavit. I emailed it to you yesterday and the day before.
Yeah, he's got it.
Okay, all right, I got the copy. I just didn't know what it was.
Okay, thank you. The respondents failed to follow many of the requirements of the Forsyth County Ethics Ordinance 77B, as amended, also known as the Ordinance, in the response to the complaint filed by me, Terence Joseph Sweeney. The responses must be supported by affidavits based on personal knowledge as required by Ethics Ordinance 2-124. No such affidavits of personal knowledge are attached. The respondents failed to set forth facts that would be admissible in evidence since there isn't any evidence attached as required by Ordinance 2-124. The respondents must show affirmatively that the affiant is competent to testify to the matter stated, but respondents fail to attach or make any such statements with a response as required by the Ordinance 2-124. The respondents fail to attach supporting documents referred to in the response as required by Ordinance 2-124. Missing substantiating documents include, but not limited to, ordinance complaint, previous complaints, Georgia Open Meetings Act, seeking out publicity, and quoted in the paper. Article 3, 2-124, 2 reads, upon a receipt of a complaint alleging misconduct, the county official or employee against whom the complaint was filed may reply to the complaint within 30 days, unless such time is extended by the Board of Ethics upon good cause shown. The response of the county official or employee must be supported by affidavits based on personal knowledge, must set forth such facts as would be admissible in evidence, and must show affirmatively that the affiant is competent to testify to the matter stated herein. All the documents referred to in an affidavit should be attached to the affidavit. The failures described herein display in an abundantly clear fashion that the respondents who has served in the capacity of the Ethics Board member does not know the rules he was entrusted to enforce. In respondent's first defense, it is stated that the complainant failed to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. Forsyth County ethics rules do not require the complainant to state a claim upon which relief can be granted. Clearly, the relief or disciplinary action is defined as the responsibility of the Ethics Board under 2-125 of the ordinance. Also, in the event there was a need for a claim upon which relief may be granted, then as described in the ordinance, this would be viewed as a technical deficiency and therefore would be returned to the complainant for a 7-day opportunity to correct the deficiency as described in the ordinance 2-124 One, if the ethics board makes an initial determination that the complaint is technically deficient, the Board of Ethics shall submit a list of the deficiencies to the complainant and offer the complainant the opportunity to correct the deficiencies within 7 days prior to the complaint being dismissed for technical deficiencies. The first offense pretends to advise Sweeney on the way to file ethics complaint. However, in the ordinance 2-124, the ordinance anticipates a violation of an employee or county official. The complaint against the board is not identified in the ethics ordinance. Further, individual participation in alleged unlawful meetings is an alleged violation. Turner seems to suggest an unanticipated method for filing ethics complaints. The votes, no votes, or participation in the meeting are individual actions at an alleged unlawful event. Respondent's second and third defenses identify the failure of the respondent in his capacity as a Forsyth County ethics member to recommend the adoption of the rules that are problematic or vague. The respondent identifies these failures of the rules after being alleged to be guilty of failing to follow the rules, but apparently never identified the flaws of the ethics ordinance prior to the complaint. Can I get another glass of water?
Sure.
Thank you. Thanks again. Thank you very much. Respondent's fourth defense fails to identify ordinance 1 and 2 or attach same as documents referenced and as required by ethics ordinance 2-124-1. Therefore, no response can be made to response. Complainant is unsure what the respondent is referring to. However, to the extent of the words substantial compliance are mentioned, it would be noted that the failure to meet on the designated times or locations are complete, total, and substantiated compliance failures. Respondent's fifth defense states that the meetings were held in accordance with the Open Meetings Act, OCGA 50-14-1. The ordinance requires all documents referenced in the response be attached. No such documents for the Open Meetings Act, OCGA 50-14-1, is attached. No complaint was made about a violation of the Open Meetings Act. Participation in the unlawful meeting dates and times failed to meet the ordinance 216C requirements, and the ordinance uses the word shall, which is synonymous with must. It should be noted that the meeting required on the second Tuesday of November failed to provide a 24-hour cancellation notice, and did the meeting that did not occur on the third Thursday, and therefore failed to comply with the Georgia Open Meetings Act for cancellation procedures. Also, the instant motion to have the ethics board attorney represent each member individually immediately after coming out of executive session is another alleged violation of the Georgia Open Meetings Act, since the purpose stated in the video audio before and after the executive session is contrary to the executive session affidavit's stated purpose. The defense of the board members individually is not a matter of the ethics board to discuss in executive session, and therefore fails the requirements of executive session under the Georgia Open Meetings Act. Two requirements of the ordinance, 2-216C, at the time the ethics board met in the wrong place, stated that the meeting shall be held in a public hearing room of the Board of Commissioners and be duly publicized and otherwise in accordance with the Open Meetings Act. Why would the two requirements for meeting locations be placed in writing if otherwise you can change the set location and requirement for timings to be set by majority vote of the ethics board? The ordinance is saying to do these two items and other than these things, do everything in accordance with the Georgia Open Meetings Act. Also see Ken Gerard's letter dated December 7, 2011 to the Ethics Board regarding meeting violations reveals these concerns also. Respondent's sixth defense states that the complaint must be within 6 months of the alleged misconduct or ethical violation. The alleged violations listed in the complaint occurred in July 2011 and November 2011. The complaint was filed in December 2011. The evidence attached by Sweeney indicated the complaints were filed in a timely manner within 6 months. The violations didn't occur until the meetings referenced in the complaint occurred. Other dates referenced supply evidence as to the failure of the alleged meetings violations in July and November. The requirements for a proper meeting could have been met 24 hours before the meeting or at the previous meeting. The previous meeting information provided reveals that the respondent failed to ensure compliance with the rules any time before the meeting violations. Individually, respondent fails to ensure compliance with the ethics meetings rules once the meeting was conducted in July and November. Respondent's eighth defense alleges Sweeney had knowledge of the violations at the time that they allegedly occurred. Sweeney became aware of the violations from a report on a local blog and a report by an individual made to Sweeney in December. Further, it is stated that Sweeney is seeking publicity and is quoted in the paper, but no evidence is attached as required by Ethics Ordinance 2-124. Sweeney has not sought publicity and did not seek an interview. Also, it's stated that Sweeney is doing everything he can do to make the board look bad. Sweeney has not blogged or sought to publicize this event, and no evidence is supplied to support the claims of everything is support the claims of everything is being done to make the board look bad. The individuals of the Ethics Board have made the Ethics Board look bad. The respondent also desires to recover fees, but fails to recognize the rules of Ordinance 2-127 that requires a public hearing. According to the Ordinance 2-127, the only way to obtain fees and expenses is from an ethics hearing. The only way to enter an ethics hearing is to find a reasonable belief that there has been a violation of the section by the county official or employee. Fees and expense recovery after respondent's request for dismissal is not provided for in the ordinance. The statement in respondent's response eight is illogical. Clearly, Sweeney had knowledge of these alleged procedural violations at the time they allegedly occurred, but did not file the instant complaint until months later. No evidence is provided to prove that Sweeney clearly had knowledge of the alleged violations at the time the violations occurred. Lauren Twiner's response in defense 12 references dates that were months earlier when no such complaints were made and when Twiner was not yet a member of the Ethics Board. It should be noted that former alternate member Turner participated in the ethics meeting on December 28, 2011, where Turner seconded motions and voted in the same meeting as Tim Perry. Perry is the very person Turner placed in the July meetings for a limited purpose, as stated in the meeting minutes. In the subsequent meeting of the Board of Ethics, the board took corrective action for the unlawful participation of Turner. In the first paragraph, the respondent identifies Terence Joseph Sweeney as Sweeney. However, later in response, it identifies Sweeney on multiple occasions. The Ernest Vasco Turner III response failed to be filed with the clerk of the Ethics Board in a timely manner within 30 days as required by the Ordinance 2-124, and therefore the Turner complaint should be considered without Turner's response. And that's about it. Thank you.
Anything else you want to say?
No, sir.
All right. Mr. Butler?
Mr. Sweeney, you were actually quoted in the paper talking about your complaints, weren't you?
I don't really recall at this time. Can you show me a copy?
No, I'm asking you a question, Mr. Sweeney. Do you not recall specifically being quoted in the Atlanta Journal-Constitution regarding these issues?
What was the verbiage?
Do you recall? I'm asking you a question.
No, I don't recall at this time.
Thank you. I don't have anything else, Judge.
All right. Anything else you want to say?
The ultimate findings, I believe, should be, if I may, to disband the ethics board, overturn all the actions at unlawful meetings, a reprimand letter, and that's about it.
Anything further, Mr. Butler?
No, sir.
All right, you move back and have a seat, Mr. Sweeney. Thank you. Anything in rebuttal, Mr. Butler?
No, sir.
All right. Why don't we do this, the gentleman? Of course, you have a right to make a closing argument if you wish. It would help me, I think, even more if, Mr. Butler, you have 10 days from today to file any kind of brief that you want to file, of any law, applicable law that's involved, and also any comment that you wish to make on the evidence. And after you've had your 10 days, then Mr. Sweeney, you'll have an additional 10 days to respond to whatever he says.
That's fine. That's how the court wishes to proceed. I'm fine with it, Judge.
Just keep you seated. All right. Is there anything else we need to do?
No, sir.
Thank you.
All right. We'll recess or adjourn, whatever we do.
All right.
Thank you.
Thank you, Judge.